I'm Vance Sebastian here with my co-host SA Baz Collins for this week's Written on the Edge interview. We'll be talking with Damian Serbu and talking about his book, The Vampire's War. Let's get to know our guest. Damian Serbu is an author of gay horror and speculative fiction. After over 20 years of teaching history at the collegiate level, he now writes full-time. He lives in the Chicagoland area with his husband and two dogs, one of which is apparently a troublemaker. Damian, welcome back to the show.
Troublemaker. Hi, thanks for having me again.
So how have you been since your last interview?
Good. Busy. I had a lot of life changes because I think since then I have fully retired from any kind of teaching or whatever and just write full time. So that's been fun.
Given the way teaching's going, it's probably a wise decision.
I know. You know, during the pandemic, teaching on Zoom, I did not get along with that. It's not my world. There's nothing wrong with online teaching and everything. It's just not how I...
It's a whole different ball of wax. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And then the other thing that's like, there's all the issues with AI now and generating essays and having to police that. And it's like, I think it's really my friends who are still in it, it's like really stressful. So I don't miss having to deal with that. I really don't miss the politics of administration and stuff too. So yeah, I've been writing away, really busy. I'm excited that this is like November and I'm getting to talk to you, because one of the weird things when you're a horror writer or speculative fiction is everybody wants to talk to you in October, which totally makes sense because it's Halloween and everybody's wanting a spook and a vampire around and everything. But then all of a sudden, like October 31st comes and it's like, okay, you need to crawl back into your cage and we'll see you
right here. So it's we're like on to happy things now.
yeah, exactly.
Well, so we have stuff to talk about. And even though it's after Halloween, speculative fiction never sleeps.
No, it does not.
And neither do monsters. So what do people need to know about the lead up to Vampire's War before we talk about it? Because I know it's not the first in the series.
It isn't the first in the series. I do, you know, and I suppose every author with a series claims this, but I try very much to make sure that somebody could read any of the books without having had to read the complete series. It does have some of the, you know, the vampires that are central to it have been in the previous books, but I think you could pick up War without having read the context, because the previous books establish the Vampire Council and highlight some of the other vampires, but aren't essential reading for this one. I think what's crucial here, though, is that I had alluded in previous novels to the fact that there was a rogue vampire who was creating tension in the vampire world. And particularly in The Vampire's Protege, he creates a vampire that lives off the vampire grid that isn't under control of the council. And several of my main characters are leaders on the vampire council. So it's, he's emerged in this novel. He's starting his war. And so that's kind of the buildup. He's challenging the Vampire Council. He's an ancient vampire and he has a beef with the oldest vampire in existence. And he's really out for retribution there. Although the story is written from the point of view of one of the youngest vampires. And it's written from that point of view because he's dating the older vampire, and he's kind of fun because he's not on the council, but he knows the council members. He kind of tries to obey authority and feels like he should, but he doesn't always like to, so he likes tension and to lash out. And then he's a good voice to hear the story from, because, you know, unlike some of the other ones, he isn't privy to all of the information. So he allowed me as the writer to kind of take the reader on a journey of discovery and tension as they went through it. The other thing that's, you know, interesting, you asked about like what I've been up to. in the last few years, with deciding not to teach anymore and other things that had happened, becoming a full-time writer suddenly was the first time in my life where I was existing without some kind of, I don't know what you'd call it, authority or entity governing what I did.
You were your own boss.
Yeah. And I, you know, it didn't hit me overnight, but in reflecting on it, I realized, well, you know, starting when you're young, it's your parents, then it's teachers, it's school, it was graduate school, then it was a job, and it was a university and an administration. And suddenly there was this void. And while it was a choice I made, Paul and I made it together, and it's been really good, and I've been really excited, there were moments of like, oh, like, you know, who do I answer to now? Or like, you know, how does that work? And what I didn't know in writing The Vampire's War is that Jared, he's the main character vampire, Jared's journey in The Vampire War often was kind of mirroring that journey for me. And what's kind of fun sometimes as a writer is you don't realize those things are going on. I was just writing this novel about The Vampire War that had been calling to me for a long time. And after I was done and it was published, I was talking to a really good friend one time. And she asked me, do you think everything that's happened in the last couple of years influenced what you were writing? And until she framed it that way and kind of confronted me with it, I hadn't realized how much Jared's journey was mimicking mine, because he has to come to terms with making his own decisions and what authority he's going to obey and what he has to do, kind of like I was. So that was a fun revelation in the midst of this.
Very nice. What a great way to tell a story, subconsciously.
I know, you know, people think authors are loopy because you talk about the muse, and I don't know how else to say it except that it really does exist. There's my characters sometimes do their own thing. There was in The Vampire's War, one of the major events that happens in my original outline did not happen, and I am, because I was a historian, academically trained as a historian, because I'm kind of like, you know, retentive, I usually have an outline and I follow it pretty closely. Mm-hmm. And sometimes the characters go in and fuck around with it. And I'm like, ah, what are you doing? Well, there was like this time they did something that like completely altered the last half of the novel. And when I wrote it, and as I was writing, I was like, this isn't the outline. You can't do this. This isn't supposed to happen, but it just felt right at the moment. So then I kept it. And then there was like a whole couple of days of my work was, I got to rewrite the last part of the outline because of you people.
Because of you people. People that you've created, no less.
Right. That's the scariest part, right?
So do you ever tell anybody what the cutscene, like the part that you cut out was?
I do. Yeah. I don't necessarily do it in this venue because it's a spoiler. There's okay. Something you don't know if this happens, or you don't know what happens to a particular character. This isn't giving anything away. Pretty early in it, Anthony, who's the old vampire, and Jared's husband, gets kidnapped. So you don't know what happens to him. So what was originally going to happen to him, that's what changed.
Got it.
So if I'm talking to people who have read the book or whatever, yeah, I talk about, I've said that before.
Fair.
And that happened, you know, I have a book coming out next year. I know we're still talking about Vampire's War, but I have a book coming out next year that was originally published by my original press. Now, my new press, Nine Star Press, is going to release it. And in tweaking it, I changed the ending on that. So that's crazy, because I thought it was just going to be a pretty simple reprint. But when I was writing it, one of the things that happened when it was originally released was some people didn't, one of the main characters, what happens to him at the end, people really liked that character, and what happened to him at the end was kind of a bummer. Mm. And so then in rewriting it, I was like listening to reader feedback and feeling like, oh, is there a way we can tweak this and change it? So,
does it enhance the story?
I think it does. I think it's... the original ending cleaned things up for the main character, kind of, so that there weren't troubles, there weren't like loose ends that were hanging around interfering with things. But this was true to the character that for whom it happened to. This is a more authentic version of him, and hopefully readers will be happy for him to know.
Nice. So why do we relate to the monsters?
You know, that's a fun question, I think. I think there are a whole lot of reasons that we really, and it's one of the reasons I like to write about vampires in particular, because you can get into their head and they have this power. And compliments primarily of Anne Rice, vampires now, you don't always know, are they bad people? Are they good people? They tend to be very complicated and in the middle ground. So with vampires in particular, but a lot of monsters, I think there are a variety of reasons that we relate to them. One, I think as LGBTQ people, there's anger within us. You know, even if you have a supportive family, and my coming out journey was a good one, I would say, but there's still anger. You face a world that tries to take away your marriage rights, where people hate you for no other reason than the fact that you exist. And so monsters, a lot of times villains, they have that anger within them. So even if you're not sitting here thinking, gee, I'd like to be a serial killer someday, or I wish I was a werewolf and I could eat everybody I saw, you do feel that rage. And there's a sense of like being able to release that. So I was thinking, you know, back to the Vampire's War, there's a scene with Jared when he's just irate. He's mad at the Vampire Council for what it's done. He's afraid. And there's just this turmoil within him. So what he does is he goes hunting as a vampire, and he deliberately seeks out a human to feed off, who is some kind of vile character who beats people, who's just, you know, not a good soul on earth, and he feeds off him. And it releases his tension and his energy. And, you know, again, I am not advocating going out and eating people if you're angry.
Well, yeah.
No.
It's not a great idea. But it's kind of fun to write about, right? It's kind of cathartic to be in that moment and say, well, what if you could just get rid of this person who's only going to hurt people and cause dementia, dissension and chaos. I think there's a strain in American history of people relating to villains. You think about one of the most iconic villains in American history is Darth Vader. You think about the Wizard of Oz. A lot of people, the first person that pops into your head is the Wicked Witch of the West. There's mm-hmm. a reason that Gregory Maguire wrote Wicked from the Wicked Witch's perspective, because it was powerful enough for him that he wanted to tell that story, and then powerful enough for readers and everybody not only to embrace that novel and what it meant, but to invite him to write sequels to it and a whole musical. Side note, the book is a lot better and darker than the musical, but
yeah,
you can't.
Yeah.
Very much so.
People want to dance and be happy in a musical, so you can't like off people left and right.
Right,
but anyway,
right.
There's that, you know, there's that relationship to monsters. And I think that, again, it's a sense of, we live where we're inhibited. We live with some ethical moral compass, or we should, most people do. And that's a good thing, but it's also like restrictive. And so there is, I think, a freedom in thinking about, well, what if that wasn't there? Why is a monster? What creates a monster, or what creates a villain who just disregards that or doesn't have it? Why is that happening? And you get inside that. And again, I don't know if it's like a total relationship to it, but it's about power. Yeah. It's about freedom from fear. You go back to LGBTQ people in the story I just told about Jared. Jared is a pretty lean, smaller set kind of was human. If you passed him on the street, he's very effeminate, and the kind of person that in the wrong setting could become a victim. Well, what if that same person wasn't afraid in that situation? You know, what if he actually was sitting there going, if you try anything, I am going to like off all of you. So I think that's part of the allure of it, the power and the mystery.
Yeah, you referenced, American, not tropes, but our sort of national spirit. And we have a spiritual vigilantism. Like, we want to right the wrongs, and yeah. We don't, because there are consequences. But when a hero in a story gets to, we cheer for that.
Yeah, definitely.
Plus, I think that as queer people drawn to the horror genre, it addresses some of the baser feelings and thoughts and darker thoughts that we have, but don't necessarily find the means to express. So vicariously, we exert them through reading stories or watching movies or teleplays or whatever with these types of characters, because it allows us that emotive release to say, yes, somebody sees what I feel and think, but I don't do in the normal world because I happen to like my life outside of the prison system, you know. So it's just, I think that's part of it also, is that it addresses those base desires, which is also why I think like vampires are much more psychological and have that thinking man's villain about them, whereas like a werewolf is more base and more visceral. And so you never have like a really astute, very, very clever werewolf. It's just, they don't really exist. I mean, yes, they have some that have some, you know, form of intelligence, but it's not on the level that a vampire operates, you know? So it's constantly these different elements that are all of us, that we all have to a degree or another, but we just don't express them. So I think horror allows us that release of, oh yes, I've been seen. Those feelings are real. I have them. I just don't do them. But you can experience it vicariously that way.
I wrote a blog post, not this year, 2022 Halloween for Horror Writers Association. It's probably still out there if people want to find it, but it was about my coming of age experience in the 80s, and how, you know, that was not a time when people came out even really in high school very often.
Mm-hmm.
In like middle school, junior high, puberty is setting in, and I start to understand, well, I've got these feelings and emotions that are not supposed to be expressed, right? I felt like this should be contained. That's really when I started to identify with villains. And I know my friends and I would get together and play like role-playing games or invent stories. We like to pretend we were going to create a movie, and I always wanted to be the villain. They were always glad I was around to be the monster or the villain or anything, because they didn't want to, you know, they wanted to be the heroes and save the day. And, you know, later in reflecting on life, I realized I had this difference within me, and everybody was afraid of it. So then I was kind of fearful of it. So I liked to be the villain because it kind of empowered that sense within me that I have a difference and it could be okay. Now, I'm glad I didn't play that out the rest of the way. You know, yeah. I came out instead of becoming, you know, a comic book villain. But I think there's an identity piece there, again, that was kind of empowering or accepting of difference. And in my, you know, young mind, I think I was grappling with, well, why would somebody do something outside the norm? Why would somebody do something unacceptable to a majority of people? And for me, it was because maybe there's nothing wrong with it. And it was an avenue then to explore that in a safe context, because I could be known as the friend who liked to be the Joker instead of Batman. And without them knowing what I was really grappling with at the time.
Yeah. All right. So is there anything about Vampire's War we didn't ask that you want to share with the world?
I think it's probably the most contemplative novel that I've written. I have a genre bending way of writing, and it's hard to categorize what I've written. So I have some that are kind of romantic, some that are a little bit more action. I have a dark satire, which is Santa's the Vampire, which is not part of this series whatsoever. But this one, and this again was not necessarily the original vision, but you really go on a journey with Jared about grappling with the world around him, grappling with his role in it. And I think as a reader, you get pulled into this concept of there's this major stuff going on, just like in our world now. There's major stuff going on, and it's frightening, and it's you want to do something about it, but you don't always know what to do about it. And Jared kind of takes you on a journey of trying to find your place within the chaos.
Nice. All right. Are you ready for our get to know you questions?
I am. These are more nerve-wracking than the other question.
Oh.
This is the funny sidebar. What I when I still teach sometimes as an adjunct one course a semester just because I love teaching. And so I give reading quizzes. And every now and then, instead of giving them all questions, I'll throw in like, okay, number five, what's your favorite pet? My students always get more anxious and upset when I ask that question. They sit there, they're like, oh, I don't know. And I'm kind of like, it's not a real question. Just write something down. Okay, so that's what I thought when I saw these. I'm like,
oh.
All right. Well, you can hyphenate. You can be a multi-hyphenate word.
Yeah, you know, I write novels. I'm used to long form here.
Right. There you go. Okay. Well, in this year of wow, what one word describes your favorite food?
Pizza.
It's fairly conducive to anything you want to put on it.
Yes, it is.
Yep. It can even be a dessert.
And you don't have to cook it.
Yeah, there you go. All right. Your favorite entertainment genre?
I'm going to cheat. I'm going to do two. I'm a big Cleveland sports fan. So professional sports, big entertainment release genre for me. But we also watch tons of movies. Love watching movies.
Okay. Where are you on the spectrum of mundane versus magical?
I like magical.
Yeah,
that's speculative fiction writer in me. Anything magical, mysterious, or otherworldly is just way too much fun.
Yeah. Because on the other end is folding clothes.
Yeah, right. And in fact,
y'all can have that.
Yeah, while you're folding the clothes, what's fun is to take your mind to a magical realm so you're not just folding clothes.
There you go. All right, your preferred level of PDA.
You know, I wish I was more into it. I think I two things. I grew up as a repressed Midwesterner, so we have no emotion that we share with anybody in the world. And then, you know, again, like when I was coming out and everything, it was like sometimes it was literally dangerous. So like I would like more PDA, but I tend to be like, oh.
Yeah. No, I get it. Even as a Cali boy, I get it. All right.
You know, I don't mind straight people as long as they don't act like it in public. So.
Yeah. I need to make a t-shirt. The gays would love that. I'll quote you.
Please do.
All right. The environment where you relax the most?
Probably home. Chilling out at home, reading with the dogs. Yeah, I like it here.
Okay. All right. Your preferred beverage?
Wine.
Yeah.
Always wine. Yeah.
Paul made me pre-show discussion. Wine.
Yes. Paul made me into a complete wino. So it's like our goat.
Hey, there's nothing wrong with that. Many suburban moms would agree with you.
And it's better than becoming a villain, right? It's better than becoming a
villain. Well, there you go. Whatever
it takes.
Plus, you compare it with your favorite pizza. See? It all works out. Okay, where do you fall on the scale of youthful naivete versus the wisdom of experience?
You know, I think I'm probably more on the part of wisdom and experience. Going back to the like repressed Midwesterner, it's a little uncomfortable to say that because it feels like, hey, I'm like super wise and experienced, but I think that's my life has taught me a lot and given me a lot of experience that I lean on more than youthful naivete. Whenever that kicks in my mind and I want that, there's some other part of my mind going, it's going to end badly for you.
We don't do child youthful naivete. Not in the Midwest.
Right.
All right. Right. Your favorite fictional character?
Armand the vampire. He's one of the vampires in Armand in Rise's vampire series. And you know, clear back when he was more of a secondary character, he just, you know, you talk about youthful naivete versus wise and experience. He's like a beautiful combination of that, because he was young when he was turned. So if you saw him on the street, you think there's this like young teenager-ish kind of kid running around. But he has years of experience, but because he was turned so young and because of his early experiences, he's not as wise as you would expect him to be for all of that power and life experience. So he's, I just always thought he was incredibly alluring, and the way he weaves in and out of the stories. And when she finally wrote one novel just about Armand, I love him. And then, if you watch the AMC series that Christopher Rice mm-hmm. did with his mom for Interview with a Vampire, this is a spoiler alert, so anybody that's not watched it and intends to, don't listen to me.
Oh, we have reactions up on our channel, so people are aware.
You're good.
Okay, because when in the last episode, when it's revealed that Louis is with Armand, I was like, I just swooned. So,
you know, it was about episode 3 or 4 that I was looking at him, and I'm like, I think it was the one where Louis was feeding on him. And I was looking and going, wait just a minute here. Cause
I know.
And I kept, and then when they did the flashback to the '70s, I'm like, that's fucking Armand. I know it is.
Yes, I know. It's so cool. And then that was kind of fun because it was a twist that took you out of, you know, they followed her novel relatively closely. They set it in a different era, but they followed the novel pretty closely. But then they've taken you out of the novel thinking, and you're thinking, oh, maybe this is going somewhere else later. So.
Right.
Yes, and there was her mom like up on the screen. And I like Antonio Banderas, but in the movie version, I was always kind of disappointed because Antonio was too old to play Armand.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely. All right. Well, finally, your favorite mode of travel?
I like to fly. I like to get on an airplane. I like to go to the airport.
I thought you just jumped off buildings.
Yeah. Well, my vampires can. So
right. Exactly. Nice. But you added plane, so I realize you're doing the mundane thing there.
Yeah, all right. Just the normal thing. Yeah, I like to get on a plane. We like to travel, so I like to go someplace else, and I like somebody else to kind of be in charge of getting me there.
Yeah, right. So you can have more wine.
On the airplane, exactly.
Exactly. Well, you made it through the list. Bravo.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I survived.
So now that Halloween is over, what's up next for you?
Yeah, so next year, my next novel comes out next year.
You teased us with it already.
Yeah, I did tease you with it already. I'd tell you the title, but that's still being worked out. One of the strange things as an author for me is I suck at coming up with titles.
Oh.
Even in like my history world, it's not natural to me. So my editor, I submitted at 9-star, I have an editor, and I just submitted it to her because I've always worked with her, and she kind of gives it an up or down vote. And when I send it to her, I have to have a title, because then in the contract, right?
Submit it.
And I said, this is the title it is right now. We're not doing this. You have to help me come up with one. So anyway, it's about a witch who comes of age during the Salem witch trials. He has to flee Salem in Massachusetts, and he becomes a pirate. And so he has witch powers as a pirate. And I've always been fascinated with pirates. I've studied a lot about them. So there's a lot of like real pirate history. There's super, you know, talk about villains who are super complicated, because pirates, people think, oh, they're extra legal and they're evil. Sometimes when you study them, are they really evil? They could be. They could be vicious to one another and other people. They also ran a fiercely democratic society, much more than like the aristocratic societies that they were rebelling against. So that's kind of fun to explore. They had a freedom that other people didn't experience. They were a lot more egalitarian, open to diversity, even like in the 1700s than. So anyway, Pirates with a Witch on Board, that's coming out next year. And I'm currently writing a sci-fi book. I have never, it's kind of horror-ish speculative fiction too. It's got a scary element to it, but I had never written anything that was sci-fi alien oriented. My brother and I, when we were growing up, were huge Star Wars fans. And he's always asking me, like, why don't you write about space? We watch Star Wars all the time. Like, I don't know, it hasn't called to me, but this story called to me. So I'm immersed in that right now.
Nice.
And it's kind of fun. The main character is a teenager. Well, he's in college at the beginning of the novel. He's a big Star Wars fan. And suddenly aliens invade. So like he's always making these references or thinking it's like Star Wars, and his friends are like, stop, this is like real world danger. What are you thinking?
I love it. All right, where is the best place for people to follow you and keep up with the updates on these projects?
Sure, the best place is my website, damianserbu.com. And also you can click a link in there and sign up for my newsletter. I promise I only send it out monthly. I started a newsletter and I was kicking and screaming about it, but it really is the best form of publicity. And I make it a unique entry every month. So those are the two best vehicles for finding out about me.
Awesome. All right. Any final words of wisdom?
No, I'm tapped out. I'm exhausted. I'm an introvert. I'm a writer. Like, I was a historian. I lived in archives. I write by myself. So like.
All right. Fair enough. Folks, we'd like to extend a huge thank you to Damian Serbu for joining us. Damian, thank you so very much.
Thank you for having me. I enjoyed it.
We at Written on the Edge are proud to introduce you to new media by queer content creators. So if you enjoy learning about new artists or hearing our thoughts in entertainment media, please like and subscribe so you get alerts for new episodes. The show is produced by Roe Ravens Media. For our disclaimers, links to social media, our listen stations, or to sign up as a guest, visit www.rotepodcast.com. Tune in next week for your queer media fix.
Bye now.
Closing time. The bums rush in melody, dear.